I honestly not comfortable with posing the problem, which is the one that I think that you want to address in terms of monoculture. Monoculture comes from the vocabulary of farming. It refers to a form of agricultural technology, and I honestly do not see very much the pertinence of introducing this term in the discussion of cultural artistic practices. Well, maybe, you know, I'm not up to date to the new development in that area, and if I had been here for the rest of the conference, I will have earned from that, but honestly, I find very, very bizarre this thing. Because I've been thinking, okay, but what is it that they are really up to with? What would they discuss in terms of monoculture? And I think that it's really a stake in this question is the issue of cultural diversity. And this is what I'm going to address, and of course I'm going to address it from point of view of the approach, which I think, you know, is relevant, and I hope that this will, in a sense, bring something to the discussion that you have been having. I've been already involved, of course, for a long time with different aspects of cultural diversity, and in fact, I have already had the occasion, particularly in my book, Agonistic, Thinking the World Politically, to indicate that I was unhappy about posing the question of cultural diversity in the way it is usually posed, you know, in terms of either a position of particularism versus universalism. Basically, I think that neither of those approaches really help us to envisage cultural diversity from an agonistic perspective. And of course, this is, you know, what interests me. And it is in that context of my critique of that approach that I have, for instance, criticized in several of my writing the cosmopolitan approach. That was very fashionable some years ago. I don't know, you know, if it still is, but in any case, there was a moment when, if you wanted to, excuse me, if you wanted to criticize particularism, it was then said, no, we need to defend cosmopolitanism. Well, for me, cultural diversity, gosh, what's happening? For me, cultural diversity is important because it provides important site of resistances against the growing cultural homogenization. And this is why I'm unhappy with the current tendency, I mean, to envisage it in terms of cosmopolitanism. To be sure, it's good to be open to the world, and it's certainly much better to be cosmopolitan than parochial. I don't know what's happening to me, really. There must be some kind of virus going on. I hope it's not the coronary virus that I've just got to get in Brussels. My God, it's not happened to me at all. This is, I mean, very strange. Okay, so that's good. Let's say that I'll be able to go on giving my lecture. So yes, obviously, you know, if we use the term cosmopolitan in a wide way, people, of course, it's good to be cosmopolitan, and it's better than, you know, not to be cosmopolitan, to be parochial. But I think that by using the term cosmopolitanism at that level, one remains really at a very superficial level. And when we really take that term more seriously, and when we are thinking more, you know, from a philosophical or I would say even conceptual point of view, then of course I think we must be aware of the implication of importing such a vocabulary in the cultural and artistic domain. indeed, the grammar, and here I'm using grammar in the term of Wittgenstein, of cosmopolitanism include a certain understanding of universality, which I take to be very problematic when the intention is to develop a progressive and pluralist approach in the field of cultural and artistic practice. And of course, this is something which is I'm very, very concerned, you know, a pluralist approach. The notion of cosmopolitanism is connoted with the idea of human unity. And it I consider this to be inimical to the recognition of pluralism. I think, for instance, that is perfectly compatible with the desire for the advent of a single culture that could be shared by the whole world. And this is this aspect that I discuss in Agonistic, and where I defend, for instance, the importance of a multipolar world. You know, when I speak of thinking the world politically, this is what I'm arguing, that we need to think the world as a pluriverse, not as a universe. But what I'm going to do here is a bit different. And I'm going to take my bearing from Claude Lévi-Strauss. So discuss, you know, really the trying to see how we can envisage cultural diversity from an agonistic perspective. And I think what's interesting and what I find very, you know, useful in Lévi-Strauss is that he has forcefully argued that civilization implies the coexistence of culture, offering the maximum of diversity and maintaining their originality. In his view, the crucial contribution of the different cultures resides in their multiple divergent variation. Okay, here there is some kind of conceptual difficulty because the term that Lévi-Strauss used is, I've never been able to translate that in English and in really other language, really. It's the question of, he speak of écart differential. And this is, you know, what I propose to translate by divergent variation. So he said, for Lévi-Strauss, the crucial contribution of different cultures reside in their multiple écart differential, divergent variation, that exist among them, and he insists on the necessity of preserving this diversity of culture in a world threatened by homogeneity and uniformity. Again, the universalist, he urges us to acknowledge that no fraction of humanity possesses a formula valid for the whole world, and that a humanity unified by a single mode of life is inconceivable because it will be completely ossified. So that, I think, is a very important argument against precisely the tendency to say, no, what we need is cosmopolitanism. We are going to oppose particularism by having a cosmopolitan view. It's interesting to see that a similar view to the one that Lévi-Strauss developed was already found in the beginning of the 20th century in the work of let's say, it's basically, it's an interesting character because he was a navigator, but also a French poet, Victor Segalen, who, in his book Essay in Exoticism, he denounced the harm inflicted in Polynesia. So it was been traveled a lot in Polynesia by Western colonization. Segalen advocated an aesthetic of diversity, and he made a passionate defense of the plurality of the world threatened by the growing process of westernization. According to him, the source and driving energy of all beauty is difference, and he claims that the sense of individuality proceeds from the capacity to perceive diversity. The sensation of individualism and what he called exoticism. And here, of course, you know, it's a term that might evoke some different thing, but what he means really by exoticism is the encounter with an other whose difference we acknowledge. So in fact, I think it's important that encounter with another whose difference we acknowledge. This is what he calls exoticism. So for him, individualism and exoticism, that is, you know, individualism and encounter with the other are complementary. Here I want to insist that neither Segal nor Levi-Strauss defend an essentialist conception of culture. That is something that would be the necessary expression of a unified substance. But that does not impede them to recognize that culture do have some specific characters that make them distinguishable from each other and that constitute their originality. This is precisely what Levi-Strauss stresses by the term écart différentiel. And he used that to stress the identity of a culture is not to be found in a pre-given essence, though it's not an essentialist one, but precisely in its divergence from other culture. I think that to think in terms of divergence and not simply differences, and I think it's a quite important difference here, is precisely what the term écart différentiel suggests. As the sinologist François Julien indicates in his book De l'Universel, and here I mentioned that he takes the concept of écart from Levi-Strauss, but does not refer to the fact that this was first developed by Levi-Strauss. That unfortunately happens often with theorists who borrow terms without saying that their origin. But in any case, what he does with that is interesting because François Julien indicates that the importance of distinguishing between divergence and difference is that divergence put in tension what it separates. It shows how other possibilities can exist which cannot be reduced to mere variation of a common invariant. And of course, you can already see why one can be beginning to think in terms of agonist encounter there. Right? And he insists that we should, instead of invariant and their cultural variation, look for equivalences and search for point of possible junction among different cultures, not simply believe that there is a master culture that a variation, but precisely no, there is a multiplicity of culture. And the écart différentiel, you know, the idea of divergence is quite crucial. Some reflection by Stuart Hall can also help us to clarify this question, particularly the anti-essentialist approach to culture when he declares, and here I'm quoting Stuart Hall, you have to think of culture as a sort of configuration of limits. It's not that it is a fixed boundary, but they are a configuration of limits, which are also the configuration of articulation. So everything is, in fact, and that's central, of course, in my work, a question of articulation. They are a configuration of articulation without which we could not speak. Because they are part of languages we inhabit that allow us to make certain kind of music, certain kind of crossover, to paint certain kind of picture that draw on three or four cognitive worlds and so on. So there is, say Stuart Hall, a positive and a negative side to it. The one thing is not, it's an open space or a supermarket shelf from which you can freely choose. So again, here it's, I think it goes in the same direction as Levi-Strauss, no? There is the specificity of culture and the idea of écart différentiel. Following Levi-Strauss, I believe that the diversity of culture is so good to be cherished. And it is important to avoid homogenization. And it is for that reason that I consider that, you know, some form of defense of universalism and the cosmopolitan approach is not the more appropriate to envisage a worldwide cultural domain informed by mode of thought and artistic practices coming from different parts of the world. that would say to think of a cultural domain, for instance, that would be able to counter the standardization imposed by cultural globalization. So it, I think this is obviously what I'm interested in, you know, how we are going to conceive cultural diversity in order to counter the standardization imposed by capitalist globalization, but without falling into some kind of defense of particularism. Despite all the effort of the new cosmopolitan, and of course, there is a lot, I think it's not so important today, but there was not a few years ago a very multiplicity of cosmopolitan. They were different, every of those people different presented some form of cosmopolitanism, and they all call, in a sense, to a form of rooted cosmopolitanism. Well, for me, rooted cosmopolitanism is some kind of oxymoron. But you know, I think that it is something really contradictory to insist on the rooted character of their vision. And because of that, despite of that insistence, they cannot liberate themselves from the core meaning of cosmopolitanism, which emphasizes the fact of a common belonging beyond all differences, and it dilutes individual attachment to specific communities. And this is why I consider that in the end, the universalist perspective promotes the hegemony of Western modernity. What happens when this hegemony is challenged and when the contingent condition of modernity are brought to the fore? When its non-universal nature is acknowledged, when we want to think in terms of divergence and not simply differences. Well, here I want to draw from some interesting discussion in political theory and history of ideas to a certain respect, particularly in a discussion about the possibility of multiple modernities. One of the central ideas of this approach is that the transition, that transition that we might recognize as modernity, took place in different civilizations and have produced different results, so different forms of modernities. Modernity should therefore be conceived as an open-ended horizon with spaces for multiple interpretation. We have to accept, for instance, that the past followed by the West is not the only possible one and not the only legitimate one, and that it should not be granted any rational or moral superiority. And of course, something, you know, in political theory, political philosophy, there is a lot of books who try precisely to prove the superiority of the modern European model. According to this approach, non-Western societies can follow different trajectories according to the specificity of their cultural tradition. So in that we can see that there is clearly again different of diversity, but not saying on a hierarchical way. There is another debate also in that the area of political theory and political ideas, which I think is relevant for our purpose. And in fact, it takes place particularly among historians of political ideas, and it concerns the nature of the Enlightenment and the plurality of possible answer to the question, what is Enlightenment? Of course, that's you know, Kant's question. Jan Hunter, for instance, has argued that there was not one comprehensive German Enlightenment that would be represented by the metaphysical approach of Kant. And in his book by Jan Hunter, Rival Enlightenment, Civil and Metaphysical Philosophy in Early Modern Germany, he has reconstructed an alternative, what he called a non-transcendental civil enlightenment, represented by authors like Pufendorf and Thomasius, who propose a very different way of dealing with the relation between religion and politics and with the sources of political obligation. He said that the metaphysical approach of Kant and Leibniz was able to gain hegemony. Here I think it's very important, this idea of hegemony, because at the moment, it's not because of superior rationality that some view become dominant. It's a question of relation of power, and it become hegemonic. You know, he said the metaphysical view of Kant became hegemonic. And that, of course, why this view and the one of Leibniz became accepted as, you know, the only legitimate one. But in no way, says Jan Hunter, should we see this as the expression of a superior rationality. As far as he's concerned, he sees the metaphysical tradition, the one that's become hegemonic with Kant and Leibniz, as being what he calls anti-political. And he finds in the civil tradition a more adequate conception of the world of politics. I think that's interesting here because it shows you that this because first I speak about the discussion about multiple modernities, you know, according to different traditions. Here we see that even within the context of the West, there is a debate about multiple possible modernities. No, it's not something between different cultures, but within the West, there is also this debate. Following the path opened by Hunter, the Canadian political theorist James Tully has developed an approach that brings to the picture other Enlightenment traditions. He speaks of the neo-Roman, the civic, the popular sovereignty. So it's not simply the transcendental Kantian and the one that Hunter calls civic. According to Tully, there are even more forms of Enlightenment. And Tully argued that the nature of the Enlightenment, which was formulated within the Kantian tradition as a transcendental question, should it be de-transcendentalized and in fact re-specified as an historical question. He also suggests that this discussion should not be confined to the rival tradition within Europe, but should be extended to a broader dialogue with non-Western Enlightenment. You can see here how, in fact, Tully's position dovetails with the approach that I mentioned before, which advocates the possibility of multiple modernities and to its challenge to the universalist narrative propagated by the West about the exemplary character of its model. I think that it's very important, this kind of reflection, because, you know, if we are thinking in terms of cultural diversity, we need to put into question this idea that there are some cultures which have got some form of superior rationality. Such a line of reflection, of course, has also been developed by post-colonial theorists. And I think it reveals the political role played by the dominant narrative propagated by the West about its exemplary and privileged path of development, and the importance of challenging the central tenets of this view. In a book called Provincializing Europe, the Indian postcolonial thinker Dipesh Chakravarti, for instance, argued that we should recognize that the appropriation by Europe of the adjective modern for itself, to speak of our democracy, is modern democracy, is been an important part of the story of Western imperialism. For me, it was really interesting to read that, and I must say it has been having impact on my work, because before reading Chakravarti, I was referring to Western democracy as modern democracy. And then I began to understand that, you know, there was a problem there, and that it's clear that for the West to define a specific trajectory as being modern, it is a powerful rhetorical weapon in establishing its superior form of rationality and its universal validity. Because if our understanding of democracy is the modern one, then in a sense it means that all the other understandings, you know, are inferior. No, so I know I'm really trying not to use anymore this reference to modern democracy and simply speak of Western democracy. The postcolonial critique is, I think, very relevant for the artistic and cultural domain. And here, of course, I'm moving away from political theory and, you know, giving the context here of this conference, I think that I rather should engage more with question of artistic and cultural practices. I think that is very relevant. This is creating a political theory for the field of artistic practices. In the visual art, for instance, we've been finding several theories who have argued for the need to pluralize modernism in this case, or also sometimes to provincialize modernism. Such a view that has been put forward by the late Nigerian curator Okwien Vezor. In fact, it was one of the first ones to introduce the discussion. And he refers to that and he put it in practice in things that he organized, for instance, like the Documenta 2002 in Kassel. He was also the curator of the Paris Triennial called Intense Proximity. That was very much influenced by those ideas. And Mvezor's approach chimes with the one advocated by Nicolas Bourriaud, who was in fact the curator of the Triennial in 2009, to which he gave the title of Alter Modernity. Well, I'm perfectly aware that I might citate some the reservation because I know that the work of Nicolas Bourriaud is not sometimes criticized by people. And I think that is basically due to the resistance of many people to his book, Relational Aesthetics. I think that, by the way, this book has been wrongly read by many people. But in any case, I'm not going to refer to this book here, because what I'm going to refer to another book of Bourriaud, which I think is quite useful for our perspective, and is a book called The Radican. As theorized by Bourriaud in The Radican, altermodernity is presented as an alternative both to the modernist universalism of postmodern and to postmodern culturalism, multiculturalism, sorry. Both an alternative both to modernist universalism and to postmodern multiculturalism. It's an attempt to redefine modernity in the era of globalization. As he put it, and here I quote Bourriaud, what I'm calling altermodernity does designate a construction plan that will allow new intellectual connection, the construction of a space of negotiation going beyond postmodern multiculturalism, which is attached to the origin of discourses and form of them rather than to their dynamics. And he wants to stress the idea of the dynamics. Bourriaud wants to reclaim the concept of modernity in a way that incorporates the post-colonial critique of its possible totalitarian implication and colonialist effects. His aim is to rethink the modern beyond the idea of the avant-garde, the universalism, progress, and radicality, to which it has previously been linked in the 20th century. He argues in favor of a new modernity, born of global and decentralized negotiation of multiple discussions among participants from different cultures and of a confrontation of heterogeneous discourses. We find in this book many references to the importance of an agonistic perspective. Such an altermodernity is to be envisaged as a process of translation, through which different cultural codes are put into relation in an attempt to transfer them from one context to another so as to make them resonate with each other. Altermodernity advocates translation, the transference of cultural practices from a traditional universe to another one, where they will be set in motion in a process of transcoding and contribute to the development of a global space of exchange organized around a common intelligibility. Commenting on Bourriaud's project in the catalogue of the Alter Modern Tate Triennial, Okwien Vezor notes that the aim of the Alter Modern is to discover what he called the current habitation of contemporary practice. It's interesting because habitation is also a concept that one finds in the work of Dipier Chakrabarty. So the habitation of contemporary practices. It rejects the rigid structure of an implacable modernity and the modernist ideal of artistic autonomy. It's also a rebellion against the systematization of artistic production based on a singular, universalized conception of artistic practices. In his view, in the view of M. Weser, Bourriaud's alter-modern approach set out to explore the eccentric and dialogical nature of art today, including its scattered trajectories and multiple temporalities, by questioning and provincializing the idea of the center, by decentering its imaginary. Well, I personally think that is a very interesting approach, but obviously it has been subject to a variety of criticism, and I think some of them are worth to take into account. And in the context of this meeting organized, you know, I know another institution organizing is international. I would like particularly to make reference to the criticism that Zdenka Badovinash is made of the view of Bourriaud. Of course, you knew Zdenka, she's the director of the Moderna Galleria in Ljubljana. No? And she has argued that altermodernity, as presented by Bourriaud, does not acknowledge the power relation that exists among the different agents of the altermodern project. And the fact that in the negotiation between agents from different cultures, a structure of power is always at play. Indeed, there might not be an accepted center anymore. You know, that's of course the critique of Aubrey. But that does not mean that all the participants are equal. In her view, Bourriaud's project of pluralizing modernism and facilitating translation between cultural codes relies on a conception of globalization that remains blind to the profound inequalities between economic and cultural exchanges. She claims that the notion of altermodernity maintains the centrality of the Euro-American modernity. I mean, it's still the modernity of reference. Badovinash proposes to see the term contemporaneity instead of modernity as an alternative precisely to modernity in the artistic field. She illustrates her proposal by explaining that while the Museum of Modern Art serves certain universal paradigms, master narrative, and, of course, the hegemonic goals of the big Western institution, the Museum of Contemporary Art must serve the need of local space so that they can enter into dialogue with other spaces. This requires, according to her, that the contemporary museum must determine its own work priorities, which cannot be universal. She asserts that contrary to the Museum of Modern Art, which serves to homogenize differences and in that way cover up dominant antagonism, the Museum of Contemporary Art should not cover the antagonism under a pluralism of pure diversity, but rather underlies them. I mean, of course, I'm very sympathetic to this idea of, you know, not trying to cover antagonism, but precisely, you know, under some idea of cultural diversity, but you know, really underlies those antagonisms. It must put forward the formation of a parallel narrative developed primarily with the help of local institutions. It must create the foundation for, she's speaking of the Museum of Contemporary Art, it must create the foundation for the reception of art as it evolves in very different contexts. For instance, it must draw attention to the difference between the Eastern and the Western social realities, and thus also the differences between the neo-avant-garde movement in those two spaces. And by the way, Bano Vinage has implemented this strategy, the Moderna Galleria in Ljubljana, where she has put together a number of projects connected with the Balkans and more generally with Western Europe. Their aim is to offer more possibilities for local institutions to produce knowledge about their own history and thus indirectly change in the global art system. Well, I agree with Bado Vinage on the necessity to taking account of the divergence and dissonance that exists among artistic practices and of the power relation with structured cultural exchange. This is obviously a view that resonates very well with the agonistic pluralism that I am advocating. But I think that it's perfectly possible to introduce this dimension in a revised alter-modern approach. That is, I don't think that it seems to imply include rejecting the alter-modernist view. I think it could be revised and introduced, and it of course will be something positive, but there are, it's not a completely different approach, it seems to me. Because of course, what is at stake is resisting the homogenizing aspect of neoliberal globalization without retreating to localism and to the defense of essentialist identities. And that is also, I mean, central both in Bado Vinage approach and in Bourdieu's approach. So this is how I think, you know, if we are going to try to think of cultural diversity in the field of artistic practices, they give really important insights. But I think that there are other qualifications that are necessary. For instance, I think that the strategy of alter-modernity revised should clearly be distinguished from the one of nomadism. The one of nomadism was also, I mean, today probably not so much, but it's also something that's very, you know, fashionable among in the artistic world. Because as T.G. Demos have pointed out, and I agree with that, nomadism lyrical and romantic tendency is in fact a non-critical one, where the poetic flight of fancy, which tend to dramatize first and foremost the artist's own privileged peripatetic existence, fails to reflexively consider the institutional, historical, and geographical parameters in which the nomadic is inhabited. In fact, say Demos, the market's voracious appetite for mobility, flux, and expansion make the nomad an exemplary role model for the transnational capitalist. So he doesn't see that, you know, or usually nomadism is seen as something very critical, and he said, no, it fits perfectly with the strategy of neoliberalism. But from an agonistic approach, which is the one I am trying to develop here, I think it's also necessary to emphasize another aspect. Emphasizing that the practice of transcoding that we are referring to here take place in a double way. It's not a simple one-way process of translating specific practices into the vocabulary of modernism. But it's a double way process in which modernism itself is radically transformed by this process of translation. And it is also necessary to acknowledge that translation are practices of displacement that produce tension and leave a reminder. As Walter Benjamin reminds us in his book, The Task of the Translator, translation always involves a violent dimension which affects not only what is translated, but also the element in which something is translated. Divergences do not disappear to translation, and we need to relinquish the illusion that a worldwide encounter of cultural and artistic practices will lead to a consensual dialogue. I mean, this for me is an idea very important because sometimes there is from the idea that, okay, through culture we are going to resolve, you know, all the problem. And I think that, no, this definitely is not going to. We have an encounter of cultural and artistic practices not never going to lead to a consensual dialogue. It will always be an element of agonism. And I think that, of course, the possibility of antagonism, because acknowledging divergence and the division, the tension, sorry, inherent in the practice of translation also forces us to be aware that those tensions could become sites of antagonism. So what's important is to try to find ways in which we maintain then by all the form of agonism. Abandon the idea of a consensual dialogue, recognize that, you know, there will always be, you know, violence, tension, and form of agonism, but what is at stake is to impede that, that to take the form of antagonism. What is important then is that those divergences are not visualized in an antagonistic mode, but in an agonistic way. And here, in order to illustrate that, I mean, I want to end by making a reference to a term which is used by Jacques Derrida to apprehend the element of violence which is present in the encounter between cultures. In his reflection on hospitality, Derrida, and here Derrida is following Benveniste, brings to the fore the deep ambivalence of the term hospitality, a term that comes from two words with the same roots, hospice on one side, host, and hostis, enemy. To express this ambivalence and indicate the entanglement of hostility and hospitality, Derrida coined the term, he loved to coin, sorry, hospitality. I think that a similar ambivalence takes place in the negotiation between different cultures, and that an adequate approach should visualize the field of artistic practices as the space where an agonistic encounter takes place between a diversity of cultures, which recognize their divergence and engage with each other without any one of them having the pretense of being the superior one. This agonistic encounter is a confrontation where the aim is neither the annihilation nor the assimilation of the other, and where the tension between the different approaches contribute, in fact, to enhance the cultural pluralism that characterizes the world. By bringing to the fore the agonistic character of the encounter between a plurality of cultural practices, such an approach might help us, I think, to address much better than a more universalist or cosmopolitan one, the crucial question to which we are currently confronted in the cultural field. This agonistic dimension is precisely what is erased in the cosmopolitan and the universalist approach, which suggests the possibility of a consensual an harmonious encounter between different cultures. So I hope that you see clearly what my strategy was to show. Okay, if we want to, and I think this is the problem that we were to, how are we going to oppose, you know, what you call monoculture, and what kind of approach could help us, you know, to view things in a different way that will be pluralistic, that will allow for agonistic. Well, I think that definitively is not going to some kind of universalist, cosmopolitan, or the idea, you know, another way, much more simplistic to put the question to that, is this debate between border and no borders, okay? So the way to oppose those who insist to cut on borders, no, it's definitely no border. I mean, no border is what precisely I will translate in terms of cosmopolitan universe. I think that's not the way. You know, we need to find another way to approach this question. That will be recognizing that some borders are necessary, because the cultures have got some form of different identity. But of course, you can conceive the way in which those borders are not going to be seen as, you know, source of antagonism, but the contrary, way in which the pluralism of the world can be enhanced, because there will be, you know, this agonistic encounter, this agonistic tension is going to lead to a much richer conception of cultural diversity. So this is the way in which I could intervene into this discussion. Of course, you know, the example that I've given, and of course is in part because of the context of this conference, I've been using question from the visual arts. But of course, I'm also convinced that by aiming at pluralizing the modern and discovering the habitation of contemporary artistic practices, those discussions in visual art have produced important insights that are valuable in the wider field of cultural and artistic practices. Aiming at the establishment of an agonistic dialogue among a variety of practices, a dialogue that acknowledges divergence and dissonances, recognizing that the world is a pluriverse whose diversity it is necessary to preserve, I think this could really contribute to bring about a better understanding of how to envisage a defense of cultural diversity. Thanks for your attention.